The fighting triggered protests throughout the Muslim world today after Friday prayers came to an end. In Egypt, crowds in Cairo and Alexandria waved Palestinian flags and chanted anti-Israeli slogans. Thousands of people also turned out in Yemen to denounce the Israeli offensive. And in Turkey, a one-time Israeli ally, people in Istanbul called for the death of the Jewish state.
And for more on the conflict, we're joined by Hisham Melham, Washington Bureau Chief for Al-Arabiya, and Dan Schueftan, Director of the National Security Studies Center at the University of Haifa and a visiting professor this year at Georgetown University. Gentlemen, one thing I think a lot of people, myself included, are wondering, how did this flare up seemingly so quickly? Dan Schueftan?
Well, since Hamas took over, we had for a while 1,000 rockets per year, approximately. Then came Israeli Operation Cast Lead, and it went down dramatically to a very small number of rockets every year. Last year, again, we came to about 1,000 rockets against Israel, and this intensified in recent weeks to the point where Israel had to take action. Israel was saying for about 2 weeks, I mean, people here were dealing with the elections and other things, but it was saying it must lead to a point where either it stops or we will have to take action. When it didn't stop, Israel took action.
Hisham, what do you think happened to build it up?
Well, we've never seen a quiet on the border, even from 2008 until now. In the few days leading to the Israeli decision to take on, assassinate a major military leader of Hamas, there were skirmishes and there were casualties on both sides. So this is really not a total surprise. But what happened, this confrontation is taking place against changing internal regional dynamics. Mm-hmm. This is the first...
You mean the much larger picture?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. The larger picture is that this is the first confrontation, serious confrontations, after the changes in Egypt and the changes within the Hamas leadership, the growing empowerment that Hamas feels that it has in Gaza at the expense of a marginalized Palestinian authority in Ramallah. You have the Emir of Qatar visiting Hamas in Gaza. You have the Egyptian Prime Minister visiting today.
This kind of thing we would never have seen, and we did never see.
Absolutely. Now Hamas is getting direct financial support from Qatar. There's political support from Turkey and from Egypt. On the Israeli side, you have upcoming elections. You have the Israeli Prime Minister saying, essentially, our deterrence should be, we should remind the Palestinians once again, or Hamas, of our deterrence, that we have a long hand. And that's why the decision came to escalate.
Well, when you think about the calculation for both sides, in Israel, the international reproach came quickly and will come if it will come even more.
No, at the moment, there is very wide support for the Israeli operation. I mean, the president of the United States went as far as saying that Hamas must stop the fire first. Mm-hmm. There is an understanding in Europe. Now, of course, the usual suspects...
I mentioned this in the region. I'm sorry. You're right. You're
in
right.
The region,
you're right.
Look, the region is hostile to Israel, it's becoming more hostile to Israel. And that's exactly the point that Hamas was banking on. The assumption that the new regime in Egypt, also Muslim Brothers, and Hamas is also, it's the Palestinian Muslim Brothers. So they assumed that Israel will be afraid of clashing with Egypt, and therefore Israel will not respond, even when a million Israelis have to sit in shelters because their cities are being bombarded by rockets before the Israeli action. I'm not speaking after. For months and months, you've had a million Israelis under threat in Israeli cities, and there was pressure inside Israel from the population saying, hey, you know, this is impossible. More than a million Israelis can't suffer for so long. So the government was told by the Israeli population that it must do it. And in spite of the fact that they knew it would be suspected of doing it because of the elections, and the Palestinians believed that because of the elections, Israel will not do it, the government had to do it.
When you think about the potential for escalation, though, can either side win this? I mean, what are they after?
The grim reality of this conflict, particularly between Hamas and Israel, is that both sides, even when they bloody each other, even when they end up with many body bags and casualties, mostly civilian Palestinians, both of them, in a crazy, surreal way, will claim victory. This is not going to change the political reality. Even if the Israelis invade Gaza, as they did in 2008, and when they inflicted and killed 1,300 Palestinians, mostly civilians, there was no political solution. Today, the only thing that is still changing, as I said, there's a regional strategic dynamics that are changing and domestic dynamics, especially with the Palestinians that are changing, the American position is still the same. And the Americans say we cannot talk to Hamas, and therefore there is we're not doing anything except giving the Israelis tacit approval and support. At the end of the day, this administration will need Egypt, will need Turkey, will need someone to talk to Hamas. Otherwise, the Israelis can buy themselves few months of respite, a year or two, and then again, that grim reality will face us again and will present us with the same problem. And that's why this crisis cries out for American leadership. If there is no American leadership, the tension will continue. You have the situation in Jordan that is teetering right now. Mm-hmm. You have a new transition that is going on in Egypt. You have conflagration within Syria. Mm-hmm. The whole region is teetering, and the whole region is brittle politically and strategically. And in the mix now, the Israelis come with this major operation against Gaza. They cannot live in the region and claim that they are not going to be touched by the reverberations taking place in the region.
Do you see a kind of political solution? And what would the U.S. role be?
I disagree with a lot of things that were said now, but in one thing I very strongly agree. There is no political solution, and there cannot be a political solution, because what you have in Gaza is an organization dedicated to the destruction of Israel, dedicated to killing of Jews. This is what they say openly. I mean, this is not an interpretation of what they're saying. Mm-hmm. This is what they're saying. As long as Israel exists, they will fight Israel. They are committed to an anti-Semitic perception of killing Jews. It's in their charter. It is in their official documents. This is what they're openly saying. Mm-hmm. And they will not leave Israel alone, regardless of what is happening. So once Israel withdraw totally from the Gaza Strip, they started shelling Israeli cities. And I also agree that whatever Israel can achieve, and it can achieve quite a lot, it achieved in Castled 4 years of tranquility, of relative tranquility. Mm-hmm. But all it can achieve is relative tranquility for a while, and then it will come up again, because the Hamas is committed to the destruction of the state of Israel.
Just a brief last word here, but you're saying it requires American leadership, but do you see that happening?
I don't see it happening. No. That's why I don't see it
and
happening.
And it can't happen, yeah.
It can't help.
No.
Well, no, look, you cannot say there's no American leadership. Otherwise, you are leaving the parties to their own devices, and there will be more conflict and more tragedies between the Palestinians and the Israelis at a time when, as I said, the whole region is teetering. And in the end, the Israelis live in that region too. And it's not in their long-term interest to allow the situation to fester like that. Yes, the Egyptians will maintain the peace treaty with Israel, but you have look what's taking place in Sinai. I mean, throughout the region, that requires new thinking. The Israelis should get out of their own traditional way of thinking that just by military means we can deal with this issue.
All right, we'll have to leave it there for tonight. Hisham Melham, Dan Schueftan, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Twitter and other social media sites lit up with eyewitness accounts from the Middle East. But who should you trust? We offer answers online.